Thank you. So first of all, I'd also like to welcome everyone. Thanks for being here and for being interested in this session. What I'm presenting today is a joint work with Evelyn Bukva, Adeline Samson, and Massimiliano Tamburino. It is still work in progress, but let's say it's shortly before being submitted. Let me start by introducing our setting of interest. It's a setting which contains the stochastic Fitzunagumo model. So we are looking at multidimensional additive noise eto-stochastic differential equations where the drift is non-globally Lipschitz continuous, but fulfills a one-sided Lipschitz condition and is allowed to grow polynomially as it is required in many applications and as it is also required for the FHN model. And these conditions guarantee the existence of a unique strong solution process, which is defined on the entire time interval and the finiteness of the moments of the solution. And we are mainly interested in the stochastic Fitzunagumo model, which actually motivated the work that I'm presenting today. So this model describes the firing activity of single neurons in the brain. It's a two-dimensional additive noise SDE where the first component describes the membrane voltage of the neuron, and the second component is a recovery variable. And what I'd like to emphasize is that this model is known as elliptic FHN model when both noise components in the diffusion matrix are strictly positive, and it's hyperelliptic if we set sigma 1 to 0. So intuitively, hyperellipticity means that the noise is propagated through the whole system via the drift of the SDE, even though it does not directly act on both components. Good, and the goal of today's talk is to construct numerical methods to approximate the solution of the SDE of interest. It means we consider a discretized time interval with equidistant time steps delta between the discrete points. And what we want to do is to construct a numerical solution that we call X tilde, which approximates the true solution at the discrete points in time. And we want that a numerical solution meets several requirements. So first of all, the numerical solution should converge to the true solution as the time step delta tends to zero in a suitable sense. And here we focus on the well-established mean square convergence. And besides convergence, we also want that the numerical solution accurately reconstructs the noise structure of the model. In particular, it should preserve the eventual hyperellipticity because this guarantees non-degenerate and invertible covariance matrices. And in addition, also very important, we want that the numerical method preserves the qualitative dynamics of neuronal spiking. So for example, the frequency and the amplitude of the underlying oscillations even for large time steps delta, because the ability to use large time steps while still producing accurate dynamics is really the key to computational efficiency. Okay, so let us first think about known numerical methods. The most frequently applied one is the Euler-Maruyama method, which is given as you can see on the slide. And it is known that this method is mean square convergence for globally Lipschitz coefficients or when the coefficients grow at most linearly. But it has been shown to fail in being convergent in the strong mean square sense for superlinearly growing coefficients as we are interested in. And since this result appeared, there has been much attention on the development of mean square convergent variants of this method. The first one appeared in 2012. It's the so-called tamed Euler-Maruyama method, and it is designed in a way to avoid large values caused by the non-global Lipschitz drift, by being designed in a way such that the drift is uniformly bounded. Okay, and later generalizations of this method, such as the diffusion-tamed method or so-called truncated methods, which make use of the maximum function, have also been proposed. And generally speaking, all these methods control the unbounded growth caused by the local Lipschitz drift by enforcing a rescaling modification to the drift or to the drift and diffusion coefficients. So in other words, they are all designed to be mean square convergent and thus meet our first requirement. But, and this is something I'd like to emphasize, they commonly fail in meeting the other requirements which are related to structure preservation. So for example, if we recall the tamed Euler-Maruyama method, it can be easily seen that the covariance given the previous value for such methods is simply given by delta times sigma transpose, which is not an accurate approximation of the noise structure of the SDE. So for example, the matrix is degenerate if sigma is degenerate, and as a consequence, it's not invertible. And this means that Euler-Maruyama type methods may yield ill-conditioned inference tools for hyperelliptic SDEs. And one thing I'd like to mention at this place is that higher order stochastic Taylor approximations may solve the particular problem of invertibility, but common or similar to the standard Euler-Maruyama method, they also fail in being mean square convergence. So it can be dangerous to use them due to possible explosions caused by the local Lipschitz drift. And in addition, Euler-Maruyama type methods also have troubles to preserve the dynamics of neuronal spiking unless the time step delta is very small. And as a consequence, they become highly inefficient or even computationally infeasible when used, for example, within a simulation-based inference algorithm. And here I'd like to illustrate this non-preservative behavior. So we consider the tamed Euler-Maruyama method and we draw paths from the FHN model for different choices of the time step delta, but always using the same underlying random numbers. So ideally, the paths should overlap. But what we observe is that the tamed Euler-Maruyama method tends to underestimate the frequency and to overestimate the amplitude of the neuronal oscillations as the time step delta is increased. So for example, if you look at the middle panel, we only observe two instead of three oscillations for a larger choice of the time step delta. And the method already deviates from the desired behavior even for very small time steps. Okay, so to overcome these issues, we went for a very different numerical approach and constructed so-called splitting methods. So the splitting approach consists in three equally important steps. Step one is to split the equation into explicitly solvable sub-equations. Step two is to derive the explicit solutions of the sub-equations. And step three is to compose the derived solutions in order to obtain a numerical method for the original equation. And in particular, we extend a splitting procedure which has been suggested for the global Lipschitz case to our setting. We focus on semi-linear SDEs where the drift consists in a separable linear term AXT and a non-linear term N of XT. And what we suggest to do is to split the equation into a linear SDE, which can be solved explicitly even in high dimensions, and to exclude the non-global Lipschitz part into an ODE that we require to be explicitly solvable, as it will be the case for the Fitzhugh-Nagumo model. Okay, and then we derive the explicit solutions of the two sub-equations and start with the first one. So standard SDE theory tells us that the explicit solution and the covariance matrix of the contained E2 integral are explicitly known, and they are given as you can see on the slide. And in a discretized regime, having these expressions, it means that we can perform exact simulation of sample paths of this sub-equation. So in particular, we arrive at the next point XTI by multiplying the previous one with the matrix exponential EA delta and by adding a Gaussian vector with null mean and covariance matrix C of delta, which is obtained as given above. And regarding the second sub-equation, we denote the explicitly known global solution by F. And in a discretized regime, we arrive at the next point XTI by plugging the previous one into that function. And as a third step, once we derive the explicit solutions, we have to compose them in every iteration step. And two common methods for doing that are the Lied-Rotter and the Strang approach. Regarding the Lied-Rotter method, it works like this. So we first solve the ODE with a delta step. We take the result as a starting value for the SDE that we solve again with a delta step. And the Strang approach, it is symmetric, which means that we first solve the ODE only with a delta half step. We take again the result as a starting value for the SDE that we solve with a delta step. And once again, we take the result as a starting value for the ODE that we solve again with a delta half step. And at this place, one thing I'd like to emphasize is that once you derive the matrix exponential EA delta, the covariance matrix C of delta, and the explicit solution F of the ODE, these two methods are really very easy and straightforward to implement. Okay, but now let us see how this splitting frameworks looks for the FHN model. So the first thing we have to do is to choose the matrix A and the nonlinear function N, which define the two sub-equations of the splitting framework. And their choice regarding the FHN model is not unique, but the nice structure of the FHN model allows us to do this in a way such that the resulting sub-equations are quite beautiful and very straightforward to solve. So, for example, if you allow two zeros in the matrix A, the first sub-equation is nothing else than the simple stochastic harmonic oscillator, where you get very simple expressions for the matrix exponential EA delta and the covariance matrix C of delta. And at the same time, noting that the first component in the nonlinear function N only depends on V, while the second component only depends on U, the second sub-equation decouples and only consists in two one-dimensional ODEs, and their solution can be derived easily, and the solution is given as you can see on the slide. Good. And now let me say a few words about the mean square convergence of the splitting methods. So it is known in the globally Lipschitz case that comparable splitting methods converge with mean square order 1, which is the same convergence order as the standard Euler-Maruyama method. And the basic idea to prove this result is to put the Euler-Maruyama method in between the true solution and the splitting solution to perform the triangle inequality and to use the known fact that Euler-Maruyama has order 1 in the case of additive noise. And in the locally Lipschitz case, we managed to prove also that the splitting methods converge with order 1, but instead of putting in between the standard Euler-Maruyama method, we use the tamed Euler-Maruyama method, which is also known to have order 1 in the case of additive noise when we are in the locally Lipschitz setting. And when we are in the locally Lipschitz case, in addition, we have to guarantee the boundedness of the second moment of the numerical solution. And basically, this is guaranteed for our splitting methods because we make use of the explicit solution of the locally Lipschitz ODE sub-equation. This solution is defined on the entire time interval without any unbounded growth. Good, then here I'd like to illustrate the mean square convergence order via the standard root mean squared error. So basically, we observe the order 1 for the splitting methods is confirmed empirically, and we see that the string splitting yields the smallest errors. Okay, and now a few words about structure preservation. So in contrast to the Euler-Maruyama type methods that we have seen before, the splitting methods preserve the hyperellipticity of the model. So for example, in particular, the Lie-Trotter method yields non-degenerate Gaussian transition densities with a covariance matrix, which is given by C of delta. And this matrix is a more accurate approximation of the noise structure of the SDE because it also contains the information of the matrix A and not just the information of the noise matrix sigma as for Euler-Maruyama type methods. And this matrix is of full rank, which is then guaranteed by the exponential of the matrix A as long as the first sub-equation of the splitting framework is hyperelliptic. And in addition, in contrast to Euler-Maruyama type methods, we observe that the splitting methods preserve the dynamics of neuronal spiking even for large time steps. So let us here we recall the non-preserving behavior of the tamed Euler-Maruyama method, and similar non-preservative behavior can be observed for the other methods. And here we consider the string splitting. So we see that when we increase the time step delta, the paths are still almost overlapping. And a similar preserving behavior is observed for the Lie-Trotter method. And I'm already approaching the end of my talk. Let me just give you a brief final conclusion. So to the best of our knowledge, the splitting methods are the first mean square convergent numerical methods for SDEs with a polynomially growing drift, as it is the case for the FHN model, which also accurately reconstruct the noise structure of the model and thus preserve hyperellipticity, and which preserve oscillatory dynamics such as neuronal spiking dynamics even for large time steps. And as a consequence, they seem to be the only methods which are also practicable for further use, for example, across the broad field of statistical inference. And with that, I'd like to finish the talk, and thanks a lot for still being around and for your attention.
Thank you very much for the talk. We have two questions. So Dmitry Todorov asked at the beginning that you are adding noise to both variables, and why is it more natural than adding it to only one of them? No, why is it more natural than adding it to only one of them? Would anything change for your numerical method if one adds noise only to one of the variables?
Yeah, so as I can understand from the literature, it's common to either have both of them, then the model is elliptic, or to only have sigma 2 and set sigma 1 to 0, then it's hyperelliptic. My feeling is that from a modeling point of view, the hyperelliptic scenario is actually the more natural one, because it naturally occurs from a modeling point of view. But sometimes it's easier to deal with the elliptic case. And I mentioned both just to illustrate that from a numerical point of view, it's not, for the splitting methods, it's not a big issue whether we have this or this scenario. We cover both settings.
Okay, and the second, we have more questions. The second question was, one could imagine that with enough effort, one can use some version of splitting method in many situations, more complicated SDEs, but it would be time consuming to make all the computations by hand every time. Are there some automatic already coded libraries for some classes of problems like that?
Not really. And yeah, this is a drawback. And in general, for splitting methods, you very rarely see like generally valid methods. Very often, it depends a lot on the problem under consideration. So I'm afraid you have to take your model and really do some a priori calculations. But I mean, yes, it requires some effort, but once you have done it, you do it once and then you can always just use it for simulations. But I'm not aware of libraries or similar.
Okay, and I have another question asked by Peter Thomas. What role does the time scale separation play in your analysis? Does it affect the splitting method?
That's a good question. So my feeling is that all considered numerical methods, so no matter whether it's splitting or Euler-Maruyama type methods, I observe that when the parameter is very, very small, then all methods have troubles dealing with that. But the splitting methods can go a bit further. So they can deal better with small values of epsilon, but yeah, I cannot really say what particular role does it play.
Okay, we have more questions. One, Lucas Wessels asks, can this be generalized to multiplicative noise?
Yes, it can for sure be generalized to multiplicative noise when you think of one-dimensional equations and you have linear multiplicative noise, because then the SDE sub-equation of the splitting framework is just the well-known geometric Brownian motion. You know how to explicitly solve it, and this will work for sure. But I'm not sure how easy it will be to derive explicit solutions for multidimensional multiplicative noise SDEs. And this is why we decided to stick to the additive noise case, because then you can really go to multidimensions.
And Peter Thomas asks, does a restriction to polynomial growth mean the method is not immediately applicable to conductance-based models? In these models, some of the coefficients grow exponentially as functions of voltage.
Yes. Yeah, that's exactly the thing. So from a numerical point of view, it's very hard to deal with something which grows faster than linearly. And in case of polynomial growth, as I mentioned, there are a few Euler-Maruyama type methods, and we tried to do the splitting, but If you have faster growth, then it can be tricky. So it's not automatically guaranteed that it works. But I can imagine that in contrast to Euler-Maruyama, splitting could tackle this situation quite well, but we did not had a look at this.
Okay, and Massimiliano Tamburino has a remark. The library for Hamiltonian for the Janssen and Ritt neuronal mass model with a little bit of statistic flavor for ABC is on GitHub. GitHub.
Yes.
So one could try that. So, okay, I think we've got a number of questions and have answered essentially all of them, I hope. Any more questions? Otherwise, I'll stop Irene and switch to the next speaker already. So it seems